In this series of figures, we want to look at capillary bulk flux. And bulk flux is the movement of water and small solutes across the capillary wall driven by hydrostatic and osmotic pressures. And what we have here is the Starling equation that describes bulk flux, or J bulk. And it equals Kf, the leakiness coefficient, times the net filtration pressure, the sum of all of those hydrostatic and osmotic pressures. The NFP equation is actually expanded down here to include all of those pressures. The P term here indicates the hydrostatic pressure, and there's one for the capillary blood hydrostatic pressure. PI is the interstitial hydrostatic pressure, which tends to be near zero. PC is the hydrostatic pressure pushing outward, right? That's the blood pushing on the vessel walls from the inside. So that's a filtrative force. Pi C is due to the presence of plasma proteins. Those proteins tend to pull water and small solutes inward. So that's a reabsorptive force. Pi I would be due to proteins in the interstitial space. There are very few of those in most tissues, but not all. And they would tend to pull water and small solutes outward. That's filtration. We'll give it a little bit smaller F here because that tends to be a smaller force. And so what we're going to have is the balance between these pressures determining whether we're getting net flux inward or outward of a capillary. Now note, we do have the reflection coefficient in here. It's important to note that these oncotic pressures, the osmotic pressures due to the proteins, are dependent upon whether the proteins are trapped on one side or the other. That is indicated by this reflection coefficient, which is this unitless measure of the permeability of these proteins. Now, normally in most continuous capillaries, that's near one, and so we could essentially ignore it, right? Because that means that our pressures due to these proteins inside and outside would be maintained. If it's zero, as it is in, for example, a sinusoidal capillary, then of course we have perfect permeability to these proteins and no gradients could be maintained. We'd be multiplying by zero. Okay, well let's come up here and look at our capillary transitioning through multiple phases of activity here. In A, we have a perfused capillary. Now it's not going to stay that way. The arterioles and the precapillary sphincters tend to constrict and dilate rhythmically over time. And that's going to transition us from a perfused to an unperfused state. But in a perfused state, we have our arterioles supplying our inflow to a simplified capillary bed here, a single vessel. And then we have our venule collecting the outflow from that capillary bed. We also have our tissue cells in the interstitium. They're being supplied by diffusive flux in and out of the capillary, but we're also having bulk flux exchanging with the interstitium surrounding those cells. And we also have a lymph vessel here to collect any extra interstitial fluid produced due to capillary filtration. Now, in the perfused state, PC, right, our blood hydrostatic pressure is dominant. It is greater than the net oncotic pressure, that pressure gradient due to the proteins. And so we're going to get net flux outward, right? You can see these outward arrows indicating our filtration across the full length of the capillary here. Now that blood hydrostatic pressure, that filtrative force does fall. As we can see, our net filtration pressure is graphed here for us. It's above zero along the full length, which would indicate filtration, but it does fall because we lose energy due to friction with the vessel walls as we traverse that vessel, and so our pressure will fall. Now, we're going to transition to an acutely unperfused state when the arterioles constrict. And the arterioles can constrict, that's going to reduce our blood hydrostatic pressure in this capillary, so PC is going to fall below our net oncotic pressure, right? Now pi C, the dominant oncotic pressure, and remember it's reabsorptive, is going to be dominant. It's going to be winning. And so we're going to get all reabsorption. We're going to have a negative net filtration pressure here. And so we get reabsorption along the full length of that vessel. That's sort of accommodating the filtration that was occurring when it was perfused. Now, a little bit longer into this constricted state, chronically unperfused. Now, they will transition through this over the course of minutes, so it's not that long. But in a more extended period of them being constricted, the precapillary sphincters and the arterioles, what we're going to find is that reabsorption flushes the interstitial proteins up against the capillary wall. Well, those interstitial proteins were, right here, a filtrative force. And so we actually transition back to filtration due to that changing interstitial oncotic pressure. And so we transition back to filtration. It's weak, but we're getting filtration again. And then the cells themselves are going to determine, they're going to release chemicals that are going to adjust, like carbon dioxide for one, but they're going to adjust the contractility of these arterioles. We're going to transition back to the perfused state. And we're just going to cycle through this, this sequence of events over time. Now, it's important to note that filtration does win overall, and we're going to get net production of interstitial fluid. That's going to produce a lymph flow. That's essential because it's taking our interstitial fluid and the solutes in it and exposing them to the lymphatic system components within our lymph system here, in the lymph nodes especially, where we find the B and T cells, white blood cells, that'll help eliminate any foreign antigens that may make it into this interstitium.